Hello students, in this session we are going to begin the next chapter, Mughal Empire. We discussed the Delhi Sultanate and learned that the last ruler of Delhi Sultanate was Ibrahim Lodi. And Ibrahim Lodi was defeated by Babur in the first battle of Panipat, and Babur established the Mughal Empire. So the first battle of Panipat, which is held in the year 1526, the Battle of Panipat, first Battle of Panipat, which is held in the year 1526 between Babur and Ibrahim Lodi, led to the foundation of Mughal Empire in India. Now let's see who are the important rulers of Mughal Empire. You know, this founder of Mughal Empire was Babur. After the period of Babur, his son Humayun became the next ruler of Mughal Empire. Then in between, Humayun was defeated by Sher Shah Suri and he had to exile for 15 years. He had to live in Persia in exile. Then again, after the death of Sher Shah Suri, Humayun came back and recaptured his power in India. But hardly he could rule only 1 year, and after that he died. Then his infant son Akbar became the next ruler of Mughal Empire. And he took over the power when he was only 14 years. Then comes Jahangir. Jahangir became the next ruler of Mughal Empire. Jahangir was the son of Akbar. Jahangir. Then after the period of Jahangir, his son Shah Jahan became the next ruler. Then after the period of Shah Jahan, the last Mughal ruler was Aurangzeb. So Aurangzeb was the, so these six rulers are considered as the great Mughal rulers. After the period of Aurangzeb, also there was Mughal Empire existed, but all those rulers were not so efficient, and we can also see the glory of Mughal Empire came to an end by the period of Aurangzeb. So that all the Mughal rulers who came after this period of Aurangzeb, they are all known as later Mughals. So all these rulers, all these six rulers, they are called as great Mughals. These six rulers are known as great Mughals. Who are known as great Mughals? Babur, Humayun, Akbar, Jahangir, Shah Jahan and Aurangzeb. These six rulers are known as great Mughals, and followed by these six rulers, all the Mughal rulers are called as later Mughals. Now we begin with the discussion of the chapter Mughal Empire. Okay, let's see the period of these great Mughals. Okay, Babur, he led the foundation of Mughal Empire in the year 1526. You remember, the first battle of Panipat was held in the year 1526, and he ruled from 1526 to 30. That means hardly 4 years he ruled India, Babur. Then came his son Humayun. Humayun ruled India from 1530 to 40, but after that we discussed that Sher Shah Suri defeated India. Okay, then again after 15 years, only after 15 years, that means after the death of Sher Shah Suri, again Humayun recaptured the power and hardly ruled 1 year. Then soon after his death, his infant son Akbar became the ruler. He ruled India for a long time, and Akbar is known as Akbar the Great, such a great ruler of India. Okay, he was an efficient ruler of India, and he is known as Akbar the Great. And he ruled India from 1556 to 1605. Then comes Jahangir. He ruled from 1605 to 1627. Then Shah Jahan ruled India from 1627 to 1658. Then finally, Aurangzeb ruled India from 1658 to 1707. So 1707, from that year onwards, we can find that decline of Gupta Empire. We consider this period, this after the age of 1707, Mughal Empire declined. Now, let us start discussing the chapter. Hello students, in this session we will go through the pages of Mughal Empire. When we discuss about Mughal Empire, in the reduced syllabus, we need to study only sources of Mughal Empire. Okay, under the sources, we have to mainly discuss the Aini Akbari and the three important monuments. Which are those three important monuments? You know, Taj Mahal of Agra and Jama Masjid of Delhi. Jama Masjid, which is located in Delhi, and Red Fort in Delhi. So these are the three important sources that you need to study under Mughal Empire. Children, what are sources for studying any history? Especially we have studied about number of history, like Harappan history we studied of Vedic civilization, Gupta period, Mauryan period, Chola. So everywhere we learn the sources. Sources means from where do we obtain the information about that particular history, particular information of the past. So similar way, Mughal period also, we obtain the information from certain sources. We are relying on certain sources to obtain the history of Mughal period. So which are those important sources? One of the most important source is that Aini Akbari. What is Aini Akbari? Aini Akbari is a textbook. It is a textbook which is written by Abul Faisal. Who was Abul Faisal? Abul Faisal was one of the nine jewels of Akbar's court. Nine jewels means important personalities. Nine important personalities of Akbar's court. And he was one of the minister and advisor of Akbar. Okay, he has written Aini Akbari and it has got five books. Aini Akbari has got five books. It is divided into five important divisions. The Aini Akbari is divided into mainly five important books. Okay, five books. The first book mainly deal with the imperial household. Imperial household in the sense, it deals with about his wives and children and his personal life, family life. Means all about his family life it is mentioning in the first part of the Aini Akbari, in the first book. Then in the second book, it mainly deals with all about servants. Servants means all the employees, the people who are working under Akbar in the administration, military, provinces, central administration, everywhere, number of employees were there. Okay, so the second books mainly deal with all about his employees. Employees means all the officials, then soldiers, all about. Okay, this is all about second book. And the third book mainly deals with regulation for the judicial and executive department and the division of empire. Okay, that it deals with the imperial administration. Third book is mainly dealing with the administration. Here mainly it deals with the law. Okay, which are the laws and rules and regulations which are made by Akbar and followed by the people. This is what the third book is mainly dealing with. Dealing with means about the central administration. Again, the whole empire is extended from where to where. And about the whole empire is divided into how many provinces. All these things are mentioning in the third book. Then the fourth book is mainly dealing with the Hindu philosophy, science, social custom, literature, etc. You know that Akbar was very much religious tolerant. Okay. So he accepted all the Hindu religious leaders, even Hindu philosophy textbook, everything in his court. Okay, so he also studied about Hindu philosophy, then he also carried out the study of science and again social custom, then literature. So all these things which are held in his period is mentioning in the fourth book of Aini Akbari. Then the fifth book is mainly consisting about the wise saying of Akbar. by saying, you must have heard about Birbal and Akbar and his wife saying, and all number of books are there. So all about Akbar's wife saying, and also all about his personal life, biography. The fifth book is also can be considered as the biography of Akbar. So you understood that what is Aini Akbari. Aini Akbari is an important book which is written by Abul Faisal, and it has got mainly five division. First division or first book is mentioning about household, and second book is mentioning all about servants of Akbar's empire, and third book is mentioning about imperial administration, and fourth book consists of Hindu philosophy, science, social custom, literature, etc., and the fifth book is mainly dealing with the wise saying and the biography of Akbar. Okay, next important source is that archaeological source. So Aini Akbari can be considered as a literary source because it is a written work. Then next we discuss about archaeological sources, means all the monuments, important buildings which are constructed are called as archaeological sources. Three important archaeological sources we have to discuss. The first one is Taj Mahal in Agra, and second one is Jama Masjid in Delhi, and third one is Red Fort. Now when we discuss about Taj Mahal in Agra, we have to just go through the features of Taj Mahal. First of all, it is constructed by whom? You all know the story. Shah Jahan is constructed for the memory of his wife Mumtaz Mahal. Okay, so it is a mausoleum. Mausoleum means what? It is a burial site. It is a structure which is constructed above the dead body or burial site of Mumtaz Mahal and Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan's dead body is also buried here. So we can call Taj Mahal as a mausoleum. And who designed Taj Mahal? Ustad Isha Khan was the person who designed Taj Mahal, and it is constructed of pure white marble. Which material is used for the construction? Pure white marble is used for the construction of Taj Mahal. Then when we discuss about the more features, it has got the dome rising to a height of 56.1 meter, and it has got minarets. Yes, I'll show you the picture of Taj Mahal here. Yeah, yes, you can see the Taj Mahal here. In this, the Taj Mahal has got four minarets. Minarets means these are minarets. This is a minaret. This pillar kind of structure is called minarets. Okay. Then it has got a central dome. Central dome, you see, this is the central dome. It's a dome structure. Okay. Then interior of Taj Mahal has got an octagonal shape. Okay. It has got an octagonal shape. And inside the chamber, okay, in the interior, inside the chamber, the dead body is buried of Mumtaz Mahal and Shah Jahan. Then, and it is constructed of pure white marble, and the central dome this is of central dome is of 56.1 meter height. This is the central dome. Its height is mentioning all about. Then again, when we discuss about Taj Mahal, more points are mentioning here. The marble dome is the center looks like a inverted lotus. That we found that central dome, no, it has gotten a shape of inverted lotus. Yes, let's see how it has got an inverted shape of inverted lotus. Yes, here you see, you can see it has got the shape of a lotus, isn't it? Inverted lotus. That is what here meant by. Then the next point that we have to discuss is that the entire structure of Taj Mahal is made up of marble. That you know that it is made up of pure white marble. And then it is also designs are made of precious stones. Then again, the method of decoration is known as Pietra Dura. Okay. The Taj Mahal's walls are decorated with a kind of particular floral painting. So, a particular kind of painting which is used known as what? Pietra Dura. What is that? What is Pietra Dura? So the Taj Mahal, what is that? The Taj Mahal is made of marble and the walls are decorated with floral designs made of semi-precious stone. So the floral design which is made up of semi-precious stone is known as Petra Dura. Clear? Okay, next. Okay, so Taj Mahal was designed as a UNESCO's World Heritage and also it is declared as the one of the seven wonders of the world. Okay, next important archaeological feature we discuss is that Jama Masjid. You can see Jama Masjid here, picture. It is built by Shah Jahan. Okay, so it has got a spacious, okay, let's see the feature of Jama Masjid in big size. Here you see it has got a spacious courtyard in the in front. Okay, Jama Masjid has got a very spacious courtyard, and this courtyard can accommodate more than 1,000 people. Okay, then it has got two domes are there. Then it has got two minarets. This is the minaret. These minarets are of 40 meter. Each minarets are of 40 meter height. Then these, it is constructed of a lofty platform. Platform means, you know, it is a raised area, and then just like a basement it is constructed, and on the top of basement this Jama Masjid is constructed. So people will have to climb the flights of steps to reach to the courtyard of Jama Masjid. Then it has got three entrance, even north entrance, south entrance and eastern entrance. Okay, then it has got inside there is a prayer hall. Inside there is prayer hall is there, and it has got arches. You see the arches, these are the arches. You can see the arches. Okay, like this 11 arches are there, altogether 11 arches are there. Then the main arches, the main arch that is reaching the up to the height of the roof, main arch, it is reaching up to the height of the roof. So these are all the architectural features of Jama Masjid, and it is constructed of red sandstone. The which material is used for construction? Red sandstone and white marble. These are the two material used for construction of Jama Masjid. Clear? So okay, now we go to back to the lesson. Here, let us see that Jama Masjid, it was built by Shah Jahan, and it is the biggest mosque in India. Then its courtyard has the capacity to accommodate, that we discuss, 1,000 people, and it is built on a lofty basement. Then it has got gateways on three sides. Then it has three gateways. Then also it has got four towers and 40 meters high, two 40 meters high minarets. Okay, this is the tower. Okay, we can only see the two tower here, and two more towers may be there. Okay, four towers and two minarets. Which are the minarets? Two minarets. Then the northern gate has 39 steps, eastern gate has 35 steps, and southern gate has 33 steps. So in order to reach to the gate, they need to climb the flight of steps because it is constructed on a basement, a pavement. Okay, so these are all about the architectural feature of Jama Masjid. And the next is that Red Fort. So Red Fort is in Delhi, and it is constructed by Shah Jahan. Shah Jahan, when he shifted his capital from Agra to Delhi, he constructed the Red Fort. You know, Red Fort has got a lot of importance, and our Prime Minister unfurls flag on Republic Day and Independence Day from the Red Fort. Okay, now even the Mughal rulers, they resided in Red Fort. That is considered as their residence. It was only British period they were removed from this Red Fort, Mughals. Okay, now let's see this. Red Fort is constructed by Shah Jahan, and it has got two main gateways. Okay, then western gateway is known as Lori gateway. Why? Because the emperor entered during the time of ceremony and all, no, they use this particular gate to enter. Then it has got two important building inside as hall complex, just like two halls were there, Diwani Aam and Diwani Khas. Diwani Khas was the hall which is used for the royal proceedings, all kind of meetings of princes and the emperors, their decisions and meeting with the officials, all these held in Diwani Khas. And even royal peacock throne. Peacock throne you must have heard about, and it was stolen by Nader Shah. Okay, when during his attack in India, he stolen this peacock throne, and right now it is not in India. It is in London Museum. Okay, peacock throne. We could not get it back. So this Diwani Khas is like a hall within the Red Fort, which is used for the royal proceedings. And the next is Diwani Aam. It is used by the public, common people, and all the common gathering, people's gathering, and king address the people and all in Diwani Aam. Okay. Then Aurangzeb, he constructed one more building within the Red Fort, that is Moti Masjid. Okay. Later on, during the period, Aurangzeb was the last greater Mughal. Okay. During the period of Aurangzeb, he constructed Moti Masjid in Red Fort. Then it is also constructed, made by red sandstone and marble, pure marble. Two materials are used for the construction of Red Fort. Okay. Then these are all about important feature of Red Fort. Then the Prime Minister of India every year unfurls the national flag on this in its ramparts on Independence Day. So these are all about the three important monuments of Mughal Empire, which provide us ample information about Mughal period. And according to the reduced syllabus, you need to study the sources. In the sources, you have to first study Aini Akbari, then you have to study Taj Mahal, then you have to study which one? Jama Masjid, and also about Red Fort, you need to study in detail. Okay, and the rest of the part of this chapter will be discussed in next session of the video.